Good morning, everyone. Oh my gosh, as TD mentioned, my name is Anndrea. I am so happy to be here. If you're watching online this morning, I just want to say good morning. I'm so glad that you're here. So we have been in this series called Images of the Unimaginable. And today the image that we're going to focus on is the image of compassion. And while we've been talking about parables or what this series is going to be, I love that it's all about parables. Because as I thought about what a parable is, I just love that it's a way that God's word and God's heart was accessible. At the time, not everyone could have access. If you weren't a scholar, if you weren't an academic, it wasn't easy for you to get access to what the Lord's heart was. But Jesus made that accessible, and he made it for everyone by telling stories of his heart. And so that's just why I'm so excited to be in this series, and I just can't think of a better place to be on a Sunday than here. So I'm so glad to be here with you guys. Thank you so much. So basically I want to go over the big idea, and the big idea is going to be that Jesus is the ultimate unimaginable metaphor of God's heart, using parables to confront our small-scale imaginations about human life and his kingdom. And I just love that you can see Jesus' heart so clearly in the words that he's going to say. And today we're going to be in Luke 10, verses 25 through 37. But before we dive into the scripture, I want us to pray so that we can posture ourselves in a position to receive and so that the Holy Spirit can come and do what only he can. So let's bow our heads and pray. Jesus, thank you so much for this morning, Lord. Thank you that we all get to be here together, God. It is so sweet to be together, Jesus. Lord, I thank you for everyone who is at home as well watching online, God. I just pray that you would bless them as they go throughout their weeks, God. Lord, I pray here, God, that we would have a heart and a posture ready to receive whatever it is that you want to speak, Jesus. Holy Spirit, I pray that these words would be yours and not mine, Jesus. I thank you for everything that you're going to do today, and I just pray that we would just be here, ready, open, and willing to do whatever it is that you're calling, God. I pray that you would stir our hearts, God. Highlight specific things for us today, Jesus, as we go through these scriptures together. Lord, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, guys, so if you have your Bible, open it up to Luke 10, verses 25 to 37. It'll be up on the screen as well. And it said, this is the parable of the Good Samaritan, by the way, just to preface it. This is the Good Samaritan. And it starts by saying, "And behold, a lawyer stood up and put him to the test, saying, 'Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?' He said to him, 'What is written in the law? How do you read it?' And he answered, 'You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself.' And he said to him, 'You have answered correctly. Do this and you will live.' But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, 'And who is my neighbor?' Jesus replied, 'A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers, who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and he saw him and passed him by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed where he came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, 'Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back.' Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers?" He said, "The one who showed him mercy." And Jesus said to him, "You go and do likewise." So what we're going to do today is we're going to basically just analyze the scripture and talk about it and understand why it's so important and why I have such a heart for this scripture. And hopefully you guys, something is stirred in your heart as well while we do this together. In the beginning it says, there was something that stood out, and it said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and all your mind." And I think as Christians, we're pretty good at doing that. As a concept, it's fairly easy. You just give it your all. You're all in for Jesus. We got this. But the next part is the one that I was challenged by, "and your neighbor as yourself." And I was like, okay, I think I'm pretty good at loving my neighbor, maybe. And the more I thought about it, the more I realized it's hard for me to love my neighbor when it's hard for me to love myself. If I can't love myself well, how am I going to love my neighbor well? And so that brings you to my first point. The first point being, love yourself through his lens. if we're able to see ourselves through the lens that God has, then we can truly love ourselves. In Isaiah 43, verse 4, it says that he sees us as being precious, that we are honored in his sight, and that he loves us. God only makes good things. You are good. I think sometimes it's hard in my life that, even like what we were talking about in offering, it's hard to feel worthy sometimes. It's hard to feel good. You compare yourself to everyone around you, and then you suddenly don't have as much love for yourself as you thought you could. And then you're only giving half of your heart to the people around you, half of your heart to the Lord, when he's created us to love the people around us wholeheartedly because he loves us and we're able to love ourselves as well. And so in here we see that. And then we also see that the people are, it says, but he desiring to justify himself said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? I find myself trying to justify myself often, being like putting up all of these excuses or all these questions like, who really is my neighbor? Really? Like, I mean, I love these people well, but who is my neighbor? And everyone is called to be our neighbor, not just within our actual vicinity, but the people that we come in contact with every day that the Lord has entrusted us with, those are our neighbors. Our fellow inhabitants of this earth are our neighbors. So start off by trying to see yourself through that lens. I know for me, it's something that I'm working on. I had a friend once tell me that you would never say the things to yourself. You would never say the things that you say to yourself to your friends. So why do we say the things that we'd say about ourselves? God never intended for us to feel that way. He never intended for us to see us as simply broken humans. It's okay to understand that we're broken, but it's not okay to dwell on that and to not understand the grace that he has given us that we can freely receive and then freely give. As we continue on in this section, it says, okay, so basically I want to go over the cultural context of why this parable is significant to the people who are listening to Jesus. So the Jewish people and the Samaritans did not get along. If you were not of the Jewish faith or of the Jewish culture, you were not considered to be an equal. You just were not. And so here we see that the person who is left for half dead was Jewish, and the priest, the Levite, did not come. But the crazy thing is the Samaritan is the one who stopped. And so this is countercultural at the time, and we know that this is just a story that Jesus was telling as an example. But that challenges the very idea of who is your neighbor. If these people were from the polar opposite, like, spectrum, who are you called to love that is the complete opposite of you? Who are you called to love that is nothing like you? For me, it's someone who probably has very different political beliefs than I do. I can be a very opinionated individual, and I'm willing to own that. So for me, this is something that I struggle with. But Jesus is softening my heart to learn that those people are more than their political beliefs. That my neighbor is more than what they post on Facebook. That's something that's very hard for me sometimes to differentiate. But Jesus died for them too. So that means I'm called to love them because they are also created in his image. And so here it talks about, but a Samaritan as he journeyed came to where he was, and when he saw him had compassion. So the Samaritan, seeing this man, another part that's very significant is that it says that the man was half dead. So in the Jewish faith, if anyone was even remote, like if you were dead and you came in contact with someone who was, or if you came in contact with someone who was dead, not if you were dead, but if you came in contact with someone who was dead, you could be considered unclean because now you are now in proximity with that person who is also unclean, therefore making you unclean by association. So it's significant that he would say that the Samaritan stopped. Now also putting his reputation at stake in this story. So it would be like me hanging out with someone who I want nothing to do with. They are not in agreement. They are not in alignment with the things that I believe, the things that are on my heart, and putting myself in a place where I am seen with them by association and now maybe going to be considered one of them. Oh my goodness. That was so challenging this week. Where I was like, oh my gosh, you want me to hang out with those people? But then I think about it and I wouldn't want Jesus to ever see me as those people, as that person who's very outspoken, as that person who doesn't believe the same thing. So this has been a very convicting message for me. This has been a very convicting passage. But it goes beyond that. We see that it says, like again, it says, but a Samaritan as he journeyed came to where he was and he saw him and he had compassion. And he could have just stopped there and just said, and he had compassion. That was it. Go love your neighbor. Go do it. But Jesus goes beyond that, and he expands on what it means to have compassion. So that's what we're going to be focusing on today. Our second point is compassion is love in motion. Jesus calls us to use our love and to actually do something about it. In this parable, we see that it says, he went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine, when he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and he gave them to the innkeeper, saying, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back. And so here we see that back in that time, oil was precious. Oil was something that you didn't just give to anybody. But this man used his oil and his wine, and he carried the man who was half dead, and he bound his wounds, and he put him on his donkey. The significance of the donkey is that if you were to put someone else on your donkey and you're the one guiding it, you are now humbling yourself in a position that is lower than the person that is on the donkey. Imagine that. These people from two completely different walks of life are now seen together, the Samaritan humbling himself. And I thought about what that means in my life and what the Lord was saying to me when I was reading this. Man, compassion means that we take that love that we have for people and we do something about it. You can tell me that you love me till you're blue in the face, but if your actions don't show it, then what do those words really mean? There have been times where I know I've had empty words. I know I have. I can own up to it. There are times where I have not been the best, but thankfully Jesus' grace covers that. And so here we see that it says he was led to compassion. So his love led him to action, which is amazing. And I thought about, okay, Lord, like, what does that look like in my life? God loved us enough that he did something about it. He saw us in our brokenness, and he sent Jesus down. Jesus loved us enough that he willingly took the cross for us because he loved us enough that he was led to action. And I just think about, wow, like, what a difference that has made in my life, that because I was so loved, something was done about it. Jesus saw me in my humanness, in my humanity, and he came and he did something about it. And Jesus does that for us every single day. So what would compassion look like for us? Like, what does compassion look like in our lives? What do you do when you're moved, when you love someone but you're moved? I wouldn't say that the people before the Samaritan despised the man on the side of the road. For all we know, they could have maybe loved him, but not enough to do something about it. I never want to be someone who loves someone just enough, but not enough to do something about it. Because Jesus loves us more. Jesus loves us abundant. And because of his great love for us, he did something. He offered us life again. He offered us new life, eternal life with him. And what would that look like if we were that to other people? So I just find myself being so challenged by this parable, I guess, just because I just wonder what it would look like if we did that in our day-to-day lives. Leading up to this Sunday, my heart was very much to preach all about the Good Samaritan and how the Good Samaritan is something that we all need to be. And I still think it is. I'm not disqualifying that. I still think that the Good Samaritan is someone that we should strive to be, because I think that is someone who puts all of these thoughts aside, all of these differences aside, in order to love someone, to exalt them, to take care of them, and to see it through. Right? And that doesn't mean that we're always going to see things through when we love people. We might just plant the seeds. We might not always see the fruit come to fruition. And that's okay. We're not promised to see everything come to fruition. But in partnership with Jesus, what that looks like for our lives to be walking with God is us just doing what we're called to do and to love people and to do it to the best of our abilities, because we're not always going to love people well. I don't always love people well. And that's okay, because the grace covers that. You don't have to be perfect, because if you were perfect, if I was perfect, we wouldn't need Jesus, and I don't want that. I just don't. So here, I was going to just talk about, oh man, everyone go and be the Good Samaritan, go and do it, go and do it. And I was so ready for the sermon to just really leave everyone with that, like, go. And this does say, the end, it does affirm that. We'll get to the other part in a second, but this part, it does affirm it. And it says, who do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? And he said, the one who showed him mercy. What does it look like for us to show mercy to people? Mercy is very countercultural now. I don't know if it was, I mean, honestly, I think it was fairly countercultural back then too, because even reading in a lot of the Bible, you don't see a lot of people that show mercy. Jesus is the one that comes in and shows mercy. But a lot of things back then, if you did something, you were going to face the consequences. You were going to get what you deserved. And if I got what I deserved, if Jesus gave me what I deserved, I probably would not be standing here right now. I would not be here. I would not be talking about it. I would not be living at the church. That's for sure. But I'm so thankful for his mercy and for who he is and that he shows us mercy. And that's the one that proved to be a good neighbor. Because I think we can do all these good deeds for our community. I think we can do all these wonderful, nice things, say all the right things. But if we don't truly show mercy to the people around us and show them love that is genuine, that comes from the Father, then what is it for? If our actions are self-glorifying, if they're for us, we're never going to be paid the amount that we think we are. We're never going to be repaid in full to the degree that we think. But if you do these things for the Lord, man, guys, that is good. He will always give you what you need and then some. So here it says, the one who showed him mercy, and Jesus said to him, you go and do likewise. And so this morning I was going to just end it and be like, you go and do likewise. And I think it's still important to go and do likewise, because I think there is room and there are two postures that we're going to focus on today. The first being that good Samaritan. And I think it's important because we need to go out into our community. We need to go out to the people that we love and the people that are around us that have been placed in our lives for a reason. Those people that I don't like on Facebook, they're probably in my life for a reason. And it's not for me to be like, oh, I'm going to get you to see my way one day. And then you'll learn, you'll understand, because my way is right, because I believe in Jesus. That doesn't mean my way is right. Jesus' way is right, but mine aren't. My ways just aren't. And so I think for me, it goes here to say, okay, we can love the people around us. We can be that good Samaritan. We can put that person on our donkey and take them out. And I think that's very important, and there's a place for that. And we need more people like the Good Samaritan to be willing to have mercy on those around us, to be willing to go out and do the hard things, to be willing to go out and do the things that are not glorifying. We need people who are willing to go and clean the foyer, people who are willing to go and do the dirty work, but also people who are willing to go and have coffee with someone. Jesus sees all of the things that you do. Whether it's seen or unseen by other people is a whole different story. But if we truly believe that Jesus is the one who has our inheritance, who has everything that we could possibly need, then it's enough. So I do encourage you to go out and be the good Samaritan to the people around you. When it's difficult, when you don't agree, when it's hard, when you have to humble yourself, because that's difficult sometimes. For me to put my pride aside and for me to say, I don't agree with you, but I'm willing to put that aside because there's a greater mission at hand. In this end part, it says, you go and do likewise. And that reminds me of Matthew 28. We talk about the Great Commission. We talk about Jesus calling us to go and make disciples, right? And that sounds fancy, but it's really just go and make more people who are following Jesus, loving Jesus, living like Jesus. That's basically just what that means. Because we have seen this, we now go model that to other people and bring them in on this. Because if we think that Jesus is so great and doing life with him is so wonderful, why wouldn't we want the people around us to have the same? I never want to gatekeep the Lord's love. I never want to hold it for myself, hold his mercy, hold his grace. Because if people withheld that from me, man, guys, things would be different. Think about your life. And if someone had not, a lot of times we experience the Lord because of the actions of other people. Whether that was just someone remembering your name. The reason that I started coming to this church was because someone remembered my name. That's the only reason I came. I did not want to come. My parents dropped me off for youth, and they're just like, go. And I didn't want to come. And because I wasn't Christian back then. And so they dropped me off, and I remember a couple weeks later we had Light the Night. And I remember my mom texted me, and I wasn't going to come. I wasn't going to go at all. And she texted me. She's like, TD, I remember because this was TD. And she said, TD just asked for you. I said, what do you mean he just asked for me? okay. She's like, no. He said, where is Anndrea? And I was like, by name? she said, yes. I said, okay, I'm coming. So clearly, like, the little things that we do matter. Being that good Samaritan to people matters. Whether you ever get to see the fruit of it or not, it's still impactful. And Jesus is going to do what only he can do. The Holy Spirit is going to come and do what only he can. It's not our job to carry it all the way. Our job is to just be Jesus to people. So now I get into my third point. It says he calls us to live out our love. Jesus wants us to go and do likewise. So we're called, if we are Christians, we're called to go and live the way that Jesus lived. Live the way that he modeled for us. and here I'm finally getting to the point that I've been alluding to the whole time. When when I was preparing for the sermon, I was really just going to end it there. I'd be like, yes, go out, go to whatever it is that you feel the Lord has called you to. And then I had a really difficult week, like a really hard week. And it's been hard for a while, but you know that there are some just weeks that just knock you down. Like there are just some times where you just go through things that are really difficult. And I was like, man, it's hard for me to just stand up here and say, oh, I can't wait to go out and just love on people, just go and do this while you're dying on the inside. You know what I mean? And it's just like difficult. And that's a joke, I'm fine. But like, I just think the Lord challenged me as I was praying and I was getting ready for the sermon. I was like, Jesus, how am I just supposed to get up there and just say, everyone go. And Jesus reminded me, I was praying and I was like, God, I don't know what I'm going to say. I want this to come from an authentic place. I don't want to be someone who I'm not. And I felt the Lord challenging me and reminding me that you are worth stopping for. Every time I've read this story, I've always resonated with the Good Samaritan. I've always taken the posture of wanting to be more like the Good Samaritan. But as I read it this time, I found myself resonating with the man on the side of the road. And I've never read it like that before. I'm like, oh. And so this time as I was reading it, he was just reminding me, you are worthy of my love. You are good because I made you that way, because I see you that way. And you are worth stopping for. And I just prayed about it, and I was like, well, what does that mean in my life? And I think about how difficult it had been, just a lot of things just coming up in my life, just it being a rough time. But then seeing in hindsight, when you're in it, you never see it. When you're in it, you never see the good in what's going on until you slightly start to come out of it. And then you can, in hindsight, see all the things that the Lord has done in your life. But while you're in it, it's very difficult. You just have to trust and hope that the Lord is going to do something to bring you out of it. And while I was angrily praying one night, as I do, I was just praying, and he told me, I have placed people in your life to be that good Samaritan to you. You don't always have to be the one that's helping everyone else. It's okay to sit there and to know that people are there for you because Jesus has placed them in your life. People who will come alongside you when it gets so difficult. People who will be there to pick you up, to clean your wounds, to put you on their donkey, and to tell you that it's going to be okay. To let you know that Jesus is there for you and that Jesus loves you so much that he loves you enough to do something about it. Jesus places people in your life that love you enough to do something about it. So for me this week, it was just have people tell me, hey, it's going to be okay. Hey, do you want to get coffee? Hey, just Gavin. People who didn't even know what was going on sending an encouraging text, because that's how good God is that he'll let you know that you are loved without you even verbalizing it. But that's not to say that you shouldn't invite people into your brokenness, because you very much should. If you don't allow for people, if I don't allow for people to be that good Samaritan to me, I can't be of use to other people if I don't allow for myself to be helped. Jesus has placed us in community to be with one another so that we can lift each other up, encourage each other, and go and do the good work as a body. There's room for both postures. We always neglect the one on the side of the road, but there is room for that as well. And it's important to acknowledge it and to talk to the people in your life that you trust that are your iron, that sharpen you, that help you become more like Jesus, to let them know what's going on so that they can walk alongside you. So whether you feel like you are the good Samaritan today or whether you feel like you're the person on the side of the road, it's okay to be either one. But know that they go hand in hand. We need some good Samaritans, and it's sure as heck okay to be the person that's on the side because we're going through this life together. Man, and I just reflect on how good it is because Jesus sees us. And he knew that we would have both of these things. And I thought about it, and I was like, well, God, why don't you just make it stop? If I'm just feeling like this, why don't you just make it stop? And I think about it, and if Jesus were to just come in and swoop in and make everything just good and dandy and wonderful in an instant, then that doesn't allow for the people that have been placed in my life to be Jesus to me. It just doesn't. It takes that opportunity. It robs another person of that blessing of being there for you. There have been times in my life where I've been so honored when people bring me in to the things that they're going through, that invite me into their brokenness so that we can invite Jesus in together and walk through it. Man, when a friend tells you, hey, I need some help right now, that is an honor to get to do life with people. And so why would I rob someone else of the honor of being able to walk through things with me? Because we weren't made to have life alone. We weren't made to do this thing alone. So today I just encourage you to remember that you are worth stopping for. That he sees you, he loves you, and he's placed people in your life for a reason. And to take advantage of that. Yeah. So I should probably invite the worship team up as I wrap up, I'm realizing. sorry, guys. So I just reflect on this, and I just think about how many times in my life God has just been good to me and has given me grace. And I'm just so thankful. I'm so thankful for who he is and who he has called us to be. And that by reading his word, by spending time with him, we're able to see who he is and who he created us to be. And that Jesus sees us, and he sees more than just a broken person. He sees goodness. He sees what you're going to become. He has so much in store for you. It doesn't matter what age you are. He's always going to do something else. He's always ready to continue to move in your life. And I'm just so thankful for who he is and who he has placed us to be. So as I wrap up, I just want us to remember. We're going to have these two questions up on the screen. The first one being, what is the Spirit prompting you with today? And then the second one being, what are you going to do about it? And then we have these I will statements that we've been doing every week. I thought about mine before I came here. And for me, my I will is that I will allow people to be the Good Samaritan to me. I will bring people into my life that Jesus has placed there for a reason. You can't deepen relationships if they're all surface level. You just can't. If you always say, I'm fine, how are you? Oh, I'm good, great, yep, okay, I'll see you later. Like, you just can't build meaningful relationships, the kind that Jesus can come in. If you don't allow for Jesus to work in your life and bring in other people, then you can't have a testimony to share. You can't have a story to tell other people the goodness of God. God has been so good to me this week. The good always outweighs the bad. Because Jesus has already overcome. He's already won. So I just encourage you to remember that he is with you and he sees you. And it's okay to not be okay. It's okay to be okay, too. I don't want you to feel like if everything is great and dandy that you need to not be. No, that's great. Do that and take that and run with it. And be that blessing to the people around you. So I'm going to pray. And then we're just going to be here and worship, whatever posture that looks like for you guys. Just sit here and reflect on how Jesus has either been that Good Samaritan to you, or how in your brokenness you can see God at work. Because when we're in it, we don't always see it, but coming out of it, you can. So let's pray. Jesus, I thank you for everyone here, Lord. I thank you that you made your word accessible. God, I thank you that there is no one who is too far gone. There is no one that is out of your reach. Lord, I just pray that today we would be able to reflect on whatever it is, God, that you're stirring in our hearts. Holy Spirit, highlight things to us that we can give to you or that we can think about. Show us the times that you have been there for us. Show us the people in our lives that have been Jesus to us so that we can go out and be that to other people. Lord, help us to choose mercy when we want to be angry, when we want to just cut ties. Jesus, help us to choose mercy and to choose love and to be like you. God, I pray that people would know that you love them, God, that you would place them in a relationship with people around them that can encourage and that can be their iron. Jesus, I pray that if people are experiencing brokenness, God, that it would be okay for them to allow other people in, Jesus, to let you in ultimately, God. Holy Spirit, we just pray that you would come and do what only you can. We're just so thankful for you. Lord, I thank you for everyone here, and we just pray that you bless them in their weeks, whether they're in person or online, Jesus. God, we just thank you for all of these things. In your mighty name we pray. Amen. So let's just reflect, and then we'll worship.